rose-colored glasses are off, it's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 46 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am once again Temitayo Osinubi, your number one resource to teach you the reality of the digital marketing landscape to propel your career. This week, I had the high honor of chatting with none other than the one-of-a-kind Barry Moltz. Barry gets business owners growing again by unlocking their long-forgotten potential. With decades of entrepreneurial experience in his own business ventures, as well as consulting countless other entrepreneurs, Barry has discovered the formula to get stuck business owners unstuck and marching forward. Barry applies simple, strategic steps to facilitate change. After successfully selling his last operating business, Barry has branched out into a number of entrepreneurial-related activities. He founded an angel investor group, an angel fund, and is a former advisor member of the board of the Angel Capital Education Foundation. His first book, You Need to Be a Little Crazy, The Truth About Starting and Growing Your Business, describes the ups and downs and emotional trials of running a business. It's in its fifth reprint and has been translated into Chinese, Russian, Korean, and Thai. Barry is now on his fifth book, How to Get Unstuck, 25 Ways to Get Your Business Growing Again, and is currently available on Amazon. Barry is a nationally recognized speaker on small business who has given hundreds of presentations to audiences ranging in size from 20 to 20,000. As a member of the Entrepreneurship Hall of Fame, he has also taught entrepreneurship as an adjunct professor at the Illinois Institute of Technology. He has appeared on many TV and radio programs such as CNBC's The Big Idea with Donny Deutsch, MSNBC's Your Business, and NPR's The Tavis Smiley Show. He hosts his own radio show, Business Insanity Talk Radio, on AM 560, and writes regularly for the American Express Open Forum and other online and offline periodicals. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention that I actually met Barry in person in Atlanta at Sage Summit, and his presentation was by far the most entertaining. This guy was handing out $5 bills left and right to get people to sit up in the front row. He was giving out lottery tickets. And he even had a game where I won a copy of his book. So this guy is the genuine article, entertaining from start to finish. And I could not be more pleased to have him on the show. So without further ado, let's get into our interview with Barry Moltz. Barry, thanks so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
We met at Sage Summit, and you were by far the most entertaining presentation. Guys, I'm telling you, this guy was handing out $5 bills. He was handing out lottery tickets, which was really amusing. We had a game show I was able to participate in, so you could just really tell that you were sitting at the feet of a master. But it wasn't always like that. Everybody starts somewhere. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug to start your own business and get in enchanted with small business marketing and getting unstuck?
I started my career at a college with IBM, and I was with them for about 9 years. And then I had a manager, a sales manager, where first prize was lunch with him. And I said to myself, what's second prize? Two lunches with him? So right. It was like, I don't think I really want to work anymore. And I met two things happened at the same time. I met a gentleman who was one of my customers who ran a small business, and it really piqued my interest on what it could be like. And at the same time, I read a book called Growing Your Business, and it really got me interested in the possibilities of what small business could be, and that's really what started my journey.
Awesome. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but it's kind of like marriage, right? When you first start, everything's new and different. Then you figure out this woman snores like a dying moose and has all these other quirks. So when did the sort of shiny veneer come off? It's like, okay, stuff just got real.
I think the shiny veneer comes off, within 6 months. Definitely having your own business is a roller coaster, as people say. It's definitely a lot up and down. Anybody can do a good job when the seas are calm. It's when it gets rough that really starts testing people. So I think, however, I did realize that I really enjoyed the ups. And as a result of the ups, I'd withstand some of the downs.
And there you have it. So now I'm going to ask you to look into your past. And so if you could hop in a TARDIS and talk to your younger self. Yes, I watched Doctor Who, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. What are the top three things you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
Well, first thing I'd probably say is, don't do it! Right. Stay at IBM, take the salary, take the pension. Keep the health insurance. There's a lot of things to be said about that. The other thing is, I would say to myself, it's okay when you fail. This is what I've been trying to teach people. Learn whatever you can, have a pity party, cheer the darkness, but then let go, take another action and see if you can get another chance of success. So try to let go as quickly as possible and make a lot of small decisions. And then the third thing I would say is, have fun, because and see where you can make a difference, because that's what being in small business is really all about. I'm never going to discover a cure for cancer, but hopefully I can help some other folks along the way.
And there you have it. And so now I'm going to ask you to look into the future, because one of the areas of digital marketing that I follow is the mobile/connected devices/Internet of Things. And sort of the default example that everybody gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your shopping list, which is then delivered via Amazon drone. And in that scenario, that's what they call a closed loop system, because, you know, you don't actually have to leave the house. Everything's real automated. And so in that future scenario where it's like the Jets, how do you see small businesses being able to, you know, compete and stay viable when it's like, you know, this is the Jetsons and Hill's boy Elroy and all that good stuff and everything is hyper competitive?
I can't believe you're even old enough for that.
I'll be 33 next week, as a matter of fact.
The Jetsons were, what, 60s, right?
Yeah, yeah. But hey, they were Boomerang, man. I grew up on Boomerang. That was my joint.
You know, listen, I think that the principles really stay the same. You know, people buy whom they know, like, and trust. And if you're trying to sell a commodity like milk as a small business owner, you are lost. You're never going to compete with a low-cost provider. So you've got to be able to sell something that has added value that isn't a commodity. And you need to create a relationship with your customer or prospect. And the good news is, I believe that technology can help you get there. You know, the buzzword for this year is really personalization. People want to seem like all the time they're having a personal one-on-one relationship with you throughout your marketing and throughout the sales process. And technology, even for a small business owner, allows you to do that.
It most certainly does. So you, Gary V, and Brian Soule.
Wow, good company.
Yeah, insert whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a different conference. You're all chilling at the bar having a no BS straight talk mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the current digital marketing industry, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Well, first of all, I would tell Gary V not to swear so much so we could have a real conversation.
Right, and then have to bleep out every word like a rapper.
You know, I think that really from a digital marketing standpoint, what is really missing is I'd like really to see there be a lot more chatbots, because I believe that there's a lot of interactions that happen with every small business, which is just by rote. It happens the exact same way every single day. And small business owners could save a lot of money. It still could be very personal and conversational if we would develop more of the chat box that are really out there.
That is the first chatbot answer I've gotten.
There
and
you
it's
go.
So timely. It really is, because I listened to the Social Pros podcast with Jay Baer, and he had a few episodes ago where he was talking about AI is where social media was 10 years ago. And is in the next 10 years, AI, chatbots, etc. It's really going to take over.
Yeah. And so, listen, Gary Vee would say fucking chat boxes. So.
He absolutely would. And so last year, March of last year, 2016, myself and my co-author, we wrote a book called Beyond Buzzwords, giving people a perspective about professional digital marketing. And by far, the buzzword of last year, 2016, was influencer marketing. Mm-hmm. And of course, you had all these podcasts and infographics pop up. And those in the space warned that it was only a matter of time before we got a spectacular train wreck, not just a regular train wreck, but a spectacular train wreck. And we've actually had a few this year. The most recent was was Kendall Jenner and Pepsi trying to profit off of the social unrest in a very ham-fisted and right. sort of tone-deaf way. But my favorite was by one PewDiePie. So for those who don't know, PewDiePie is like the original rags-to-riches YouTube success story. He went from just a guy with a YouTube channel, and now he makes right around $4 million a year. He was the first YouTube channel with a billion, that's a billion with a B, views, and he previously had relationships with Disney and Maker. And the reason I say previously is because PewDiePie fashions himself as an amateur humorist, and he decided to take shots at the website Fiverr and all the crazy things you can get people to do for as little as $5. But the way he chose to go about this was by hiring people to say and do anti-Semitic things. And of course, the fallout was swift and immediate. Disney immediately dropped him. But this actually sparked some blowback from PewDiePie's following, which is substantial. And so Chris Brogan on the Marketing Companion podcast raised a very interesting point that the way that younger millennials and digital natives use language is fundamentally different from the way older generations use language, and what offends us doesn't offend them. And so my question to you is two-part. In this, you know, clickbaity, fake news, ever salacious internet that we find ourselves in, do you think that, you know, this will embolden people who are looking for their, you know, 15 minutes of fame and don't mind running amok to do it to be ever more outrageous? And also, PewDiePie's original, what he was trying to, you know, accomplish was he was actually taking shots at the gig economy and how the gig economy is kind of eating away at, you know, expertise and professionalism and just sometimes can get out of hand. So do you think that, you know, he was right to take shots at, you know, hiring somebody for $5 when you really should hire a professional, or, you know, was that just out of line as well?
Listen, it's a complicated answer. I mean, the answer all the way around, I guess, is yes. You know, people are going to become – the good news about the internet is you can find your tribe. The bad news about the internet is you can find your tribe. Whatever you think, whether it's you know, whether it's anti-Semitic or against this group, whatever it is, you'll be able to find the people that share, you know, those thoughts. And I believe, unfortunately – people are trying to become more and more outrageous, especially with the fake news, because fake news and outrageous things do gain traction. I think that's something that really got its foothold in the 2016 election. So I think it's going to become increasingly a problem out there, because a lot of times the conversation just is not really humane, unfortunately.
It is not. And let's dig a little bit further on that. So without getting political, you know, to the best of your ability, but by all means, if spirit moves and you want to go on a Gary V style fucking rap, you can absolutely do that. What's your take on the whole fake news fallout after the 2016 election? And just to back up for those who may not know, in the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news began to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, I mean these stories were wholesale fabricated, had no factual basis in reality. It was not a simple matter of spinning the facts one direction or another, which all news does. MSNBC leans left, Fox News leans right. There were no underlying facts to be spun. Like these were fairy tales. And when this first came out, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off. He was like, oh, no. It's highly unlikely Facebook had anything to do with it. But then in his February 2016 open letter, he conceded that fake news has outstripped Facebook's ability to govern it. And they are in the process of rolling out third party verification and AI, some of those chat box you were talking about earlier, to sort of curb the effects of it. And this has sparked a really interesting debate in the digital marketing community, because you have some who are like, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth. And then you have others who are like, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say, you're away on business, and while you're gone, some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool, and one of them drowns. You put up a fence. They were trespassing. Doesn't matter. Happened on your property and you are responsible. So again, without getting political, staying more so on the marketing side and Facebook's response to it, how do you feel how do you feel Facebook has done a good job or not on handling this situation?
Well, first of all, I'm confused because you mean that Hillary Clinton really did not run a child prostitution ring at a pizza restaurant in Washington, D.C.?
Yes, that did not, in fact, happen. Oh, but shots were fired. By that. You know, I think
I think this is really the apex where, you know, when the internet first came out, people said, well, if it's on the internet, it must be true.
Right.
And people have now taken that belief, people's belief, and it's really turned ourselves against us. The fake news phenomenon is really real, and it's real both on the right and on the left. I mean, we're typically, you know, a lot of us, for like myself, who are left-leaning, we see, you know, we're always accusing the right, the people on the right of fake news, but I see on the left too. You know, I see things like, you know, Donald Trump is going to get indicted tomorrow, right? And it's like by the Palmer Report, things like that. So unfortunately, both sides do it. Now, I think the problem you have with Facebook is I personally think it's just a platform, and we shape that platform by what we personally want to see and hear. So, for example, for myself, I have unfollowed anybody who is a supporter of Donald Trump, right? So I only see news, and I only see that I want to see. I only see, quote unquote, half the news or 57% of the news, but that serves me just fine. But I realize I've shaped Facebook the way that I want to see it, and I don't really think that Facebook has a responsibility to be the arbiter. I think that, quite honestly, now truth really doesn't exist. There is no truth outside ourselves. That is really one of the casualties of the 2016 election and fake news.
Brave new world. Very, you know, scary times. We can't even agree on what's true or not. So we're going to take a short break. And then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Barry Moltz. So stick with me.
We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave, and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it. Hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now, I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon.
And we're back. So, Barry, large corporations have just now really started to get serious about digital marketing. And I'm really interested in your answer of this for being a small business owner in your area of specialization, because you know, for a long time, you know, your Coca-Cola's, your Nike, they sort of treated digital marketing like a fad. But now that they are serious, they're dumping their elephant dollars into the digital marketing ecosystem. And the laws of supply and demand dictate that as you have more competition for a limited amount of ad inventory, you're going to see those costs per click rise. And we have seen the cost per click get more expensive over time. And so, you know, what can theoretically happen is that you could have a future scenario where digital marketing becomes less viable for small businesses and every other post is, you know, powered by Pepsi. So do you think that as time goes on and the measurement gets better, that the, you know, the big boys with their behemoth budgets will sort of edge out the smaller players and smaller businesses? Or do you think that true to its disruptive roots, once digital marketing becomes saturated with corporate dollars, that something new will pop up?
I think that something new will pop up. I mean, if you look at it, most of the time, the people that are doing the disruption and reinvent the industry are folks that are outside the industry. So one of the things that people always point out, and I could not be happier about it, because I hated taxi cab services because I think they offered horrible service. They never showed up. They were rude. They talked on the phone. They smoked. And when Uber came along and totally disrupted that, they were outside of the industry. So I think that when something becomes too saturated by the corporate giants, someone else will create a new way to break through. I have no idea what that's going to be, but I think it'll be there.
I certainly hope so, because, you know, I'm a small business myself as well. And it's definitely going the way of getting saturated. So fingers crossed. Now, one of the things that larger businesses can do that smaller businesses can't is programmatic buying. And that's when they buy display ads primarily, but you can buy other ad formats as well. And they do it via algorithm and they do it at large scale. But unfortunately, one of the more funny things that has happened, what wasn't funny for the brand, is that sometimes the algorithm gets it wrong and you'll have a company like Disney and they'll have an ad that shows up on a KKK site or something like that. You'll have a brand show up on a wholly inappropriate site. And so the issue of brand safety has really come back into the limelight for a lot of folks. And you have kind of this war. Well, war might be exaggerating a little bit, but you have this back and forth between brands and publishers like Google and Facebook, because they're saying, hey, you guys have made billions of dollars off of other people's content. And now my brand is being damaged because your algorithm isn't right. And then Google is like, hey, we're doing the best we can, but algorithms, they're sort of, you know, tricky things. So where do you stand on the whole brand safety debate? Do you think that, you know, your brand reputation, your brand safety is ultimately always your responsibility, regardless of what Google and Facebook's algorithm does? Or do you think that Facebook and Google owe a greater, you know, fealty to make sure that, you know, when people purchase programmatic buys, that they, you know, they don't advertise on the Ashley Madison site or something?
And I've had the founder of Ashley Madison on my radio show, so I know all about that site. I really believe it depends what, you know, Google and some of these websites are promising, because mistakes do happen. I believe in the end, if you're going to do this programmatic buying, your brand is your responsibility. And there's been things in the press, like you're talking about, you know, Disney advertising a KKK site, or, you know, people advertising on the Breitbart site that didn't really want to be there. But I think ultimately what is being promised by Google, and you're still responsible for your brand, and mistakes are going to happen, and you've got to weigh the risk.
Indeed, that's just how the dice rolls. So last question, I'll let you get back to your day, and I do appreciate you taking the time. However, I am going to take just a couple minutes to set it up, because I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it. So in my opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I'm talking about somebody who works in-house at a brand or agency. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely say they're pros because they operate at such a high level. It's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs. So just in general, in terms of professionalizing yourself, the three ways that people do it is they sort of, you know, roll the dice on Google. They sell their firstborn to the Department of Education, which was I did. They go back to school, or they have to mortgage their house so that they can attend a conference or a seminar, because some of these things, you know, all in could be upwards of $3,000 to $5,000. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to crowdsource a way of professionalizing yourself that does not include those other three options, which I just mentioned. So now I'll ask the actual question, which is, Imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right. You are college freshman broke, Barry. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer, Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
I guess what I would really do is I'd reach out to the industry thought leaders and see how I could help them and how I could ingratiate myself to them and what could I do for them. And eventually, if you go out to enough people, someone's going to take you up on that, where it's going to be something meaningful and not just go get me coffee, go get my laundry. So that's really where I would start. And I actually did that when I left, when I sold my last business. I was trying to really understand, how do you get into the angel investment space? And all I really did was ask people if I got 15 minutes of their time on the phone, ask them a bunch of questions, and then sent them a small gift afterwards. And that worked out really well. Now, if I was a poor freshman, again, I could do the gift part, but I'm not sure people much care.
There you have it. Very well said, Barry. This has been tremendous. Please take a moment. Tell us about your books. Tell us about your new book coming out. Give us all your social media handles. Yeah. Where can we get some more of you?
Sure. Well, I'm the Unstuck guy. I have Small Businesses Get Unstuck. And you can go to barrymoltz.com, BarryMoltz.com. I've got a new book coming out in the fall. It's called Small Business Hacks, 100 Shortcuts to Your Success. And you can find me on Twitter at barrymoltz. On Instagram at Barry Moltz, at Facebook at Barry Moltz, and all the other places, it's all just my name. It's real easy.
Awesome. Small Business Hacks. Look out for that, folks. You definitely want to pick that up. I met the man in person, got his last book, and I'm telling you, it's an experience you don't want to miss. Barry, thanks so much for your time.
Appreciate it. Thank you for having me.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482.
Please hang up and try again.